Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Foster the Family, Encouragement, Hope, and Practical Help for the Christian Foster Parent by Jamie C. Finn. Narrated by Jamie C. Finn. For my husband, who sacrificed so much for this book and this ministry and this foster care life, your partnership makes it all possible. Your love keeps me going. For my parents, who taught me that I can do anything, but that the only things worth doing are done for Him. Welcome to my life. My eyes bolt open. Still hovering between asleep and awake, I fight to remember what I'd been dreaming about. Whatever it was, I think my kids were screaming. As I retrace the memory, I hear it again and realize it's the actual sound of my actual kids downstairs screaming. Squinting, I dial into the muffled sounds from below. Are those happy screams? Are they playing? That's mine! I hate you, I hear. Nope. I hop out of bed, hoping the toddler asleep in the crib across my room isn't disturbed by my urgent steps or by the screaming downstairs. The sleeping toddler was a baby girl of 5 months when New Jersey's DCP&P called about placing her. But that was about 18 months ago, on Christmas Day. My husband and 5 kids, which included our foster son, a 2-year-old boy with the biggest, brownest eyes you've ever seen, were opening presents by the tree. Not only was it Christmas, but the next day was my husband's birthday. I thought it might be a hard sell, so I put on my best doe eyes. Babe, it's Christmas. She's at the police station. She needs a home. It didn't take much convincing. Yeah, of course, tell them yes, he replied. When they brought her over, she lay asleep in her car seat for an hour, while we all circled around her, commenting on her long fingers and pink eyelids. Rule number one of foster parenting, and of course parenting, never wake a sleeping baby. She used to sleep through anything, but not anymore. Now I had to tiptoe. 2 of the other 4 kids, who shall remain nameless to protect the guilty, are awake and fighting over an old prepaid phone that lost its minutes and ability to charge, not to mention worth, 3 years ago. I rub my half-open eyes and start in with my best gotcha parenting. Girls, what do you love more, the old phone that doesn't work or your sister? One characteristically looks at the ground and shuts down silent. The other characteristically stomps off to her room and screams, "The phone, stupid! I hate this family! I wish I had another family!" Right on cue, the toddler starts to cry upstairs. I comfort both the shutdowner and the screamer with long and silent hugs, and correct them with the reminder that toys that provoke wars between siblings are confiscated for the day. It's band-aid parenting for sure, but I have to get on with the morning. We have the crisis mental health case manager coming at 9 and the toddler's new worker coming at 9:30. I need to get 5 kids bathed, dressed, fed, and hopefully no longer fighting in 2 hours' time. It's looking like a 2 out of 3 day for me, so I choose bathed and dressed and skip my breakfast in favor of brushed teeth. 3 cups of coffee and a psalm is my busy morning go-to. The hot shower washes away the night's aches. God's mercies are new every morning, and a good shower certainly helps. These 7 minutes will almost certainly be my only alone and quiet time this morning, so I think through the day, starting with the kids' assignments. We're in our first year of hybrid homeschooling. 3 days of classes at school with teachers and other kids, 2 days at home with me and their siblings. I used to homeschool full-time until work started to pick up, and being both a homeschooling mom and a work-at-home mom, 2 mutually exclusive roles, became impossible. Work for me isn't easily defined. I write about foster care on the internet. I host a podcast. I speak at conferences. I also own a business that sells products that center around and benefit foster care. and I'm the founder and executive director of a nonprofit organization that serves local foster families. It's a little bit of a lot of different things, but it all centers around this one thing: foster care. When I became a foster parent 7 years ago, I never could have known how it would take over every part of my life. I write and talk about, fundraise, plan, encourage, and strategize for, and live foster care all day, every day. My husband and I talked about adoption in a probably one day sort of way ever since I met and fell in love with him at the ripe old age of 14. But 10 years in, we hadn't taken any steps. When my brother and sister-in-law adopted through foster care, we thought they were crazy. But God used them and others, along with books and scripture, to convict and convince us. We signed on with a nervous on Alan's part and excited on my part, willingness to accept one healthy child at a time on a very day-by-day sort of basis. We were going to try this thing out, see how it went. 24 kids of various ages, 2 adoptions, and an array of medical needs, behavioral issues, and circumstances later, I'd say we're pretty much in it for life. We approached our yes to foster care with our 2 biological kids, Liv and Wes, 5 and 2 at the time, in tow. Since then, our family has permanently grown by 2 more through the adoption of 2 of our foster daughters, Bella and Em. Our house has 3 open beds that are almost always taken up by 1 or 2 other kids as the need arises. If you're counting, that's 4 to 6 kids, 4 forever children, and 1 or 2 temporary foster children. Right now, the lineup of our 5 kids includes Liv, 12 biological, Wes, 9 biological, Bella, 7 adopted from foster care, Em, 6 adopted from foster care, and Jovi, 2, foster. I typically subscribe to a labels don't matter, they're our kids mindset, but for our purposes in these chapters, I think the distinction is helpful. As I jump out of the shower and throw on my at-home uniform of yoga pants and a tee, I get a text from the toddler's lawyer. Are you available for a video conference today at 2? I set a timer on my phone for 1:45 before even responding with yes. I completely forgot about the video conference that was scheduled for last Friday, and I can't let that happen again. Once may be forgivable, but twice is not. One thing is for sure, all the appointments and paperwork of foster care have confronted my forgetful, disorganized self head on. I get everyone dressed and fed semi-successfully. Yes, one kid's sensory processing issues meant we had a 15-minute meltdown because the only pair of acceptable pants, despite the 8 pairs of perfectly fine pants sitting in the dresser, was sopping wet in the washer. And yes, one of the kids hid in the kitchen cabinet, nowhere to be found when they heard a social worker would be visiting. And yes, the toddler threw an entire tray of food onto the ground while repeating, in mockery of me, I'm convinced, as I'm on my hands and knees cleaning it up, uh-oh, 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 but they're all dressed and fed. As I get the big kids started on their schoolwork, there's a knock on the door. The crisis mental health worker, a 20-something guy wearing a Star Wars t-shirt, pulls one kid into the dining room. They talk behaviors and stressors and goals until the conversation eventually devolves into playing Nintendo together. Another knock on the door, new worker. We shake hands as she looks into the dining room and starts to introduce herself to the therapist. Oh no, she thinks that's my husband. This is one of my other kids and their therapist, I explain. You can come into the living room. Over time, the cast of workers, lawyers, and therapists so regularly in my home has become the norm. The worker and I talk about the upcoming court hearing. She's brand new to the case, so I actually know far more than she does. I narrate the timeline and characters and plot up to this point in an effort to get her caught up. She talks about the biological mom in a tired kind of way, like she has already given up on her. She really loves her, I offer, but I can only imagine how easy it is to open a case file like hers and write her off immediately. The worker adjusts her tone to meet mine. I hope she can do what it takes, she replies. I'll be back next month, she adds, as the therapist walks into the room to say his goodbyes too. They look at each other again, both trying to figure out the other. I walk them both to the door. In case you've never done it, walking two completely unrelated people to the door at the same time is more awkward than you'd think. They both head out, and the kids and I jump into the rest of our day. I practice the letter R with one. What's this? I ask, showing an image of a rug. Carpet, she yells out proudly. Close, I congratulate. I gather the crew for history and read aloud about the French Revolution. The kids are fascinated with the idea of a guillotine and take turns falling over, decapitated and dead. I see the opportunity for a Les Miserables solo. No, the kids laugh. This may not be the first time I've done this. We wrap up school and move on to nap time and screen time, bike rides and board games, snacks, snacks again, more snacks, and asked for again and denied snacks. When the timer rings at 1:45, I pick up my phone with confusion. I stare at the buzzing screen for too long, trying to remember what the reminder is supposed to be reminding me of. When I finally do, I thank myself for setting it. I log on to the computer and prepare for the video conference with the lawyer. Hi, Jamie, I hear through the pixelated screen. I can hear it in her voice. Bad news. Or at least news she doesn't want to break. She passes right over the niceties. So the court ordered for you to go to the prison with the child to meet Dad. My voice sounds chipper. Okay, that's fine, I say as I drag my palm against my forehead, forgetting for a moment that the video betrays me. Are you willing to do that? She inquires, noticing that my actual language and my body language don't match up. Yes, of course, I answer and look into the camera. This time, I remember to smile. When I close the laptop, the babysitter is my mom, knocks. I give her the rundown of the day and a few guidelines. They already had screen time, so outside time, please, and Alan will be home by 5:30 with dinner, so don't worry about feeding them. Sounds good, she agrees, as the kids circle like seagulls. Mom, look! Mom, come here! Mom, wanna see? One snack each, I say firmly as I walk out the door. She already knows the one snack rule, but I say it for the benefit of the listening kids who are sure to pester her for 2 or 3 or 10. Today's work is my day job, so to speak, working at the Foster the Family offices. My team and I serve a network of 200 local foster families through emergency and holistic care. The emergency care occurs immediately after a foster family welcomes a new child. One of our on-call volunteers visits our office and builds a foster care package of new clothing, supplies, hygiene items, and special comfort items for the specific age, gender, and needs of the child who was placed in the foster home. They also deliver a homemade meal and information about our resources. That's where the holistic care comes in. We host support group meetings, respite babysitting nights, trainings, and special events. We have a helpline and offer mentorship. We throw parties and buy gifts, and we send care packages and deliver supplies. Really, what we do is provide a context for foster parents to find community and receive support. Serving alongside our staff of 6 and volunteer force of 50 takes up much of my time, brain capacity, and heart. As I drive to the office, I get a notification on my phone that one of our families is out of diapers, wipes, and formula and can't get to the store because the whole family is sick. I've got this one, I text my director of operations. I'm usually stuck behind a desk or sitting in meetings, so I don't often get to serve foster families hands-on. But this family lives 5 minutes from me, and I need a periodic feet-to-the-ground reminder of why we do what we do. So I decide to tack it on to my drive home. Afternoon turns to evening through the window above my desk. I pack up the bundle of baby necessities for the local family, making sure to grab a fun surprise for each of the sick kids. Car rides, empty, alone car rides, have become my happy place. I listen to my favorite podcast as I head to the house of the foster family. I don't want to disturb them or get sick, so I drop the package on the doorstep and send a text before driving home. I left everything at your door. Feel better soon. Reach out if you need anything at all. It's official. No one else needs me for the rest of the day. I turn on my music and head home. Alan pauses the basketball game as I walk in. I get a rundown of the kids' day. Highlights include a meltdown over mac and cheese, a blowout diaper, a 15-minute search for the remote that was both hidden and found by the same kid, one child's nightly panic attack about brushing teeth, and a night terror. But, of course, highlights also include sidewalk chalk with Mom, a dad versus kids game of soccer, grilling and eating on the deck, and an 80s kids movie with popcorn. A normal day, really. Equal parts challenging and exhausting, blessed and sweet. Alan shares about his workday, and I share about mine. He reaches for my hand and smiles, saying, "I'm proud of you," like he does at the end of most days. As we crawl into bed, Alan notices the light of my iPhone. "What are you doing?" he whispers. "I have to post something on Instagram real quick," I reply. It's not an unusual answer. Some people may consider social media a time waster, but it's an important part of my job. Sharing about my life and about foster care on the internet each day leads me to contemplation, readjustment, and worship. I pull up a photo to post and my cursor blinks in expectation. I think through the day with all its busyness and challenges. I think about how abnormal some of the normal parts of our day are. I think about how hard it can be to have kids who are affected by mental illness, drug and alcohol exposure, trauma, and neglect. I think about how much I sometimes want the system out of my home and my day. I think about how exhausting and endless this work of supporting other foster families and children can be. I think about it through the lens of all that I know, all that I've come to learn, all that I believe, and I begin to type. My path into brokenness began with a prayer. God, break my heart for the things that break yours. He broke my heart. And he broke the lie that this life is about me and my happiness, broke the quest for a perfectly average life, broke the desire for ease and success and passing joys. There's great beauty in a life of brokenness by decision, a shattered heart seeping out the sacrifice of praise, a life cracked open and poured out in worship to him, an invitation for God himself to make me whole. Hashtag foster care. I turn off my phone and place it on the bedside table. I roll over and whisper, "Alan, yeah? I forgot to tell you one thing. I emailed our worker today and told her we're ready for another placement." He makes a sound that's hard to distinguish in the dark, but that I know is a laugh. At least I hope it is. I'm sure if I could see him, it would be accompanied by an eye roll and a conspiratorial smile. "Okay," he whispers. I kiss him on the forehead and rest my head on the pillow. Time to get a good night's sleep. Tomorrow, we do it again. Introduction. I was big into Shakespeare as a teen. Now, before you get the wrong idea about what kind of teenager I was, you should know that this was right around the time Leonardo DiCaprio and Claire Danes played Romeo and Juliet. My obsession may have had less to do with the bard and more to do with the heartthrob. Whatever my introduction to 16th century theater, I was hooked. I consumed every Shakespeare play, moved on to the sonnets, and landed in the biographies and commentaries and literary criticisms. It was there that I learned that when Shakespeare wanted to communicate something and couldn't find the right word, he would just make one up. And he didn't make up one word. He invented as he went 1,700 words that you and I use on a daily basis. Words like arouse and rant and negotiate and lonely. Lonely. Can you imagine the English language without the word lonely? To my little budding writer's heart, making up a word you thought should exist was about as presumptuous and beautiful a concept as I could imagine. It still is. I'm no Shakespeare. I officially nose-goes the job of choosing the word. But there needs to be a word, just for foster parents, that says it all. We need a word. Something that encompasses every conflicting emotion and thought and experience, without all the caveats and buts and I feel A and also B and I think I'm supposed to feel C's that typically pepper our speech. Bittersweet doesn't cut it. All the feels has been hijacked by teenagers who have not in fact felt all the feels. We need something else, a guttural, can't-be-put-into-words expression that gathers up the depths of every contradictory thought and emotion all at once. Being a foster parent means that nothing just makes sense anymore. It means we can no longer sort thoughts and feelings into wrapped-up pretty packages. It means spending much of our life confused and conflicted and overwhelmed. Half the time, we don't even know what we want. Most of the time, even our prayers are perplexed. We regularly wade through the depths of opposing experiences. It's all so much, I just want someone to tell me, here's how you should think, here's how you should feel, here's what you should do, now go on, you've got this. It may still be hard, but at least I would know what I was doing. But there's no handbook for foster parenting. Maybe because no two children, parents, cases, workers, judges, plans, outcomes, behaviors, diagnoses, emotions, challenges, or overall experiences are the same. Probably because none of us know what we're doing enough to write one. But God is kind. He has given us a handbook for life, His very words in Scripture. Thank the Lord, the Bible is more than just a how-to manual, more than a list of rules and expectations. It's a map. And not one primarily for our journey through this life, but one outlining His journey to us. It's one beautiful plot, woven by God in eternity past and touching the moments of our present days. God's word speaks to every part of life, even the parts where it seemingly doesn't. I've never found the words foster care in the Bible, but I have found rich truths about God and humans, family and children, sacrifice and trust, forgiveness and love. Foster care is all throughout the Bible, God speaking to us, commanding and encouraging, teaching and comforting. I wish foster care had a manual. It doesn't. And I wouldn't dare presume to write one. I'm not an expert, and I don't have all the answers. This book is not a how-to kind of book. It's a from-the-trenches kind of book. A wrestling with God in the desert kind of book. Most of all, this is a tasted and seen kind of book. I pray that my times of digging through God's word and searching for an answer bring you some direction. I pray that my grappling with the difficulties of this life of foster parenting produces for you some level of peace. I pray that my tripping and falling on my face allows you to avoid the same pitfalls. I pray that God meets you through listening to this as He's met me through writing it. 1. What did I do to my life? We were like a group of vets sharing war stories. Like old men sitting around a campfire, patches from wars both won and lost emblazoned on hats, sharing old tales with that so strange combination of sadness, sentimentality, and pride. Each tale sadder and stronger than the last, growing in drama and volume as the night goes on. War stories. Telling of their unseen wounds, finding communion in their shared battles. Our gathering was all of that. Except, you know, the part about the old men and the war. It was actually just me and my gal pals lounging on a tweed couch, drinking coffee and doling out goldfish crackers, soothing toddler tantrums and tween dramas. But the experience was the same. We told tales of foster care battles past and some very, very present. We exposed the war wounds of trauma and loss and hellos and goodbyes. We savored the camaraderie of shared experience, sitting with those who could understand, finding comfort in the amen like, mm-hmm, and the laughters that said, I see you. The girl's grandfather OD'd. Do I tell them? Her IQ test came back at 64. Forget what this means for school next year. What does this mean for the rest of her life? She had a hallucination last night that bad men were touching her butt. It looks like he's going home. Well, by home, I mean the homeless shelter. Her therapist said it will probably be a lifelong struggle. Mom's parents just showed up after 15 months and are filing for custody. Just a few friends on a normal Thursday morning, sitting around and chatting, wading through the heaviest of heavy. I shot wide, tear-brimmed eyes at my fellow soldiers slash warriors slash just plain old foster moms and laughed, guys, what did we do to our lives? Who does this to their life? Who chooses to uproot a normal, one boy, one girl, happy life for hard and broken? Who signs on for tears and sleepless nights? Who opts in for poop smears and calls to the police for family court and social worker visits? You and I, foster parents. Counting the costs. The only person who chooses a life full of difficulty, chaos, and pain is the one who has weighed the other options and decided that the benefits exceed the costs. Being a foster parent entails costs, true costs. And like line items in a budget, they add up. Less time with other children, fewer peaceful morning cups of coffee, increased stress, decreased health, marital stress, days and weeks missed at work, restless nights, heartbreaking goodbyes, less time for passions and pursuits, fewer invitations to dinner with friends, missed promotions, rare quiet nights in, lack of sleep. Some costs you can see and measure. Some are imperceptible in the short term and invisible to others. Yet each cost is tangible, bringing you deeper and deeper into the red, depleted and poor and on the way to bankruptcy. But what about the benefits? The joys? A child's laughter, good grades, reunification, adoption, the victories. She told me she loves me. She's becoming less afraid of men. He told me the truth when I asked him. Mom said thank you. He's opening up about the past. She slept through the night. She smiled. We had such a fun day as a family. Dad has been sober for 3 months. Are these joys and victories enough? Is the math as simple as the good outweighs the bad? If you're new to the game, you may still be running on adrenaline and happy moments. But time and kids and parents and workers and behaviors and investigations and reunifications and failed reunifications can beat the honeymoon right out of you. And the question stands, why am I a foster parent anyway? Foster parent, this is a question you have to be able to answer with clarity and confidence, with a foundational kind of answer. You need a sustaining truth that transcends situations, conditions, thoughts, and feelings. Your reason cannot be circumstantial. It must be theological. Worth it. I shouldn't have picked up my phone. I should have just ignored it. Why did I even pick it up? I stomped through my sister's backyard, calling the kids out of the pool. We huddled in the corner of the yard as my kids' cousins looked over their shoulders in question. Guys, I looked into each of their eyes with compassion. The worker just called, and they're coming to pick up Dom in 5 minutes to move him to his great aunt's house. We need to say goodbye, quickly. A cacophony of little voices responded, "What? No, we're not even home. He doesn't even have his stuff. This isn't fair." "I know. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. Now give him a kiss." When the worker arrived, the same worker who had brought him to our home from the NICU, the same worker who had talked about adoption every conversation for 6 months, the same worker who had confirmed there's no family willing to step in, I couldn't even look at her. "Judge's orders," she shrugged. "You couldn't have followed the judge's orders tomorrow or tonight?" I questioned. Her tone shut down my questioning completely. "My daughter has a dance recital." I kissed the forehead of the boy I'd called son for the past 6 months, walked to the backyard, and promised myself, I'm done with foster care. "I'm done," I repeated to Ellen on the phone. My husband hadn't even gotten the chance for the quick forehead kiss that I had. "Jamie, we're not, yes, we are. Or at least I am. I am done," was my final answer. There were too many sacrifices, too much heartbreak, too much loss and injustice and frustration, too many reasons to be done. When we got home, I clicked on the TV for the kids, knowing the screen could offer them more than I could, and sent myself to my room. I paced around the rug at the foot of my bed and allowed the tears to stream and collect at my chin. I hate this. I don't want to do this to myself or to my kids anymore. I don't want this to be my life. I don't want to feel this way anymore. I'm done. I finally got tired of crying and pacing and pulled out my journal. It's where my battles are fought. Feeling my feelings, thinking my thoughts, and then reorienting all that to what I know, what I believe, to what is true. I hate foster care. None of this is as it should be. A baby shouldn't have to be taken from his mother 2 days after birth. A worker shouldn't just leave a few minutes to say goodbye. A family shouldn't have their hearts broken over and over. It's not supposed to be like this. This system and this whole wide world are broken, broken, broken. But it doesn't shock you, oh God, when I shake my fist at it all, when I say I hate this and I say it to you, it's said like a prayer, a faith-filled acknowledgement that though this isn't how it should be, you are above it all. A desperate cry that though I feel like I can't do it anymore, you will give me the strength. A worn-out and weary statement of faith. I do all of this for you. A held close conviction that it doesn't matter how hard, this is worth it. What has carried me through the hardest moments of foster care and carries me still is remembering and believing and knowing deep down that foster care is worth it. The costs and trials and pain are overcome by the value, overwhelmed by the worth. Foster care is worth it. But sometimes I need to be reminded of why that's true. Children are worth it. Mothers do hard things out of love for their children. This is a loving and sacrificial choice, I said to the woman crying on the other end of the line. You could label her prostitute or heroin addict, but really, she was just a mom trying to figure out how to do right for her baby. 7 months pregnant and well aware that she couldn't give her daughter the life she needed, she was looking for an adoptive family to step in. Her friend knew I could help with that and shared my phone number. "I don't know why this happened like this," her voice trailed off. "I don't either, and I am so sorry for the pain you are walking through right now," I tried to empathize. "But I do know one thing. God created this precious life. He is the one who formed her in your womb. He already loves her and already has a good plan for her. He chose you to be her birth mother, and he's already chosen her forever family. Her little life is precious to him." She continued to weep as I grew silent. All children are precious. Their human lives are created in the image of God, mirrors reflecting the glory of the Heavenly Father, likeness bearers of the Almighty. Every child is artfully and lovingly handcrafted by the Creator. Before time began, each child was loved and cherished and planned. All children were on the heart of the Savior as he bled in love. No past abuse, current struggle, or future prognosis. No gender, race, or ethnicity. No medical diagnosis, mental illness, physical handicap, behavioral issue, or educational classification. No thing, not one thing, nothing steals 1 ounce of the divine image from a child. No label or prefix or description that marks a young soul as other can detract from the inherent worth of a child. Any day or life spent serving precious children is one well spent. Families are worth it. Today, the highlight of my day is my foster daughter's video call with her mom. She kisses the phone and toddles away with it, laughing and chatting her baby language into the screen. She loves her mom, and she loves getting to talk to her mom. After 10 minutes, I confiscate the phone and get on for my turn. I talk to her mom, this stranger-turned-friend whom I've come to love, about the job she got at Amazon the day before. She just moved back from out of state, so she's in transition. I asked her what she's been eating. "Don't worry, I'm eating," is her response. "Oh yeah, what?" I wait. "Text me a list of what you need and I'll drive it over in the morning." "Thank you, Jamie. Love you." "I love you too, Kelly." "Say, love you, mommy," I direct our girl before we hang up. If you would have told me 7 years ago, when I first became a foster parent, that this was a conversation I would someday have, I never would have believed you. I came into foster care understanding that children are worth it, but struggling to believe that families so broken, so far from what they should be, are really worth trying to repair. I'll delve into this in the next chapter, so I won't belabor this point here, but family is important because it's been called so by God. The family is a theologically rich picture of the Trinity, the church, and the people of God. The family is the divine plan for a human's physical, emotional, psychological, and relational needs to be met. It's as important an earthly institution as can be, and it's smack dab at the center of foster care. Playing a part in foster care, in families being healed and reunited, is important work because the family is important. Living for Jesus is worth it. I still remember the commencement speech at my best friend's high school graduation. It was corny and cliche, but it was almost 20 years ago, and I'm referencing it in my book, so I guess it did the trick. The pastor handed a dollar bill to each of the graduates and charged them, "You have one life to spend. Spend it on what matters." It put a lump in my throat and a fire in my veins. I don't want to waste this one life. I want to spend it for Jesus. For me, This is the why of foster care. Really, it's not the kids or the parents. It's something, someone else completely. I'm not a foster parent because I know that children need homes, or because I believe families should be reunited, or because I love adoption. I'm a foster parent because I love Jesus, because I want my life to be lived in surrender to Him, my days spent in worship of Him. Others may worship Him as missionaries or teachers or plumbers, but I've been chosen for this messy and beautiful work of children and families. And the days when the costs are the greatest are the days when my truest worship is offered. Those are the days when foster care is less about cuddling babies and more about giving myself to my God as a living sacrifice. The answer. My question, what did we do to our lives, was said in jest, but it's one I've wrestled with, ugly and dirty. This is the answer I've arrived at. It's not really my life in the first place. My life has been ransomed and purchased. I've been bought with a price, so now I belong to God. And above and before how I follow God is the fact that He made me His follower to begin with. My life is not about what I'm doing for Him. It's about what He has done for me. And it's from this place that I follow Him into what He has called me to do. It's at this place that the costs all make sense. You see, God does the best kind of math. His math is the kind where nothing adds up, but we always come out ahead. The kind where we merely re-gift to Him what He gave us in the first place and are rewarded for doing so. The kind where what we sacrifice for Him now waits for us in heaven later. The kind where we deserve nothing and He gives us everything. In the end, this is where the line items are reconciled, where the costs and rewards are balanced. Yes, kids are worth it. Families are worth it. But do you want to know why foster care is worth it? Because it's gospel work. And living for Jesus is always, always worth it. 2. Jesus loves the little children and their families. I always say I became a foster parent for the wrong reason. No, not the money. I mean, the whopping dollar an hour to lose all sense of privacy and have the state invade your home and parent a child full-time 24 hours a day and pay for every bite of food and activity and article of clothing and deal with behaviors and sleep struggles and food issues and have awkward interactions with parents and workers and chauffeur to therapies and appointments and visits and ride the roller coaster of the court system and ultimately have your heart broken is tempting. It's a pretty sweet get-rich-quick gig, if you ask me, but no, it's not the money. And no, it's not the praise either. Although the side eyes and wow, you have your hands full and inappropriate questions are quite fulfilling, I just love being noticed. Sometimes people are so impressed they go so far as to point and whisper. There's a lot of, how should I put it? Recognition involved. No, it's not that either. It was for neither of these stereotypically bad reasons that I got involved in foster care. It was another wrong reason completely. I got into foster care for the kids, and only the kids. I got into foster care to protect children from their horrible, criminal, addicted, selfish parents. I got into foster care believing reunification to be the unfortunate byproduct of this whole system. I got into foster care forgetting that as precious to the heart of God.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.